Trinity Church on this last Sunday of Epiphany, the Sunday of the Transfiguration. It's a joy to see you all. Thank you for being with us in Trinity. A special welcome to those who are visiting or new this morning. We're so glad you're with us. We continue with the opening sentences on page 2 of your book. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be God, Savior, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Run the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
First of all, you must understand this,
that no prophecy of Scripture is a matter of one's own interpretation, because no prophecy ever came by human will, but men and women moved by the Holy Spirit spoke from God. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. of the living God. Jesus took with him Peter and James and his brother John and led them up a high mountain by themselves. And Jesus was transfigured before them, and his face shone like the sun, and his clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, "Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them. And from the cloud, a voice said, "This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him." When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, "Get up and do not be afraid." And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, "Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord.
Jesus liked to pray there,
out himself, and so Jesus would ascend Mount Tabor. And one day, the story in our gospel tells us, he took his best friends, Peter and James and John, and they accompanied him up the mountain. He wanted to show them his favorite meditative place. Maybe they had asked him if they could go along sometime to the place where he communed so closely with God. And Jesus loved and trusted these friends. He was open to sharing with them where he retreated, how he prayed. And so there on the mountain, he began to pray. And we can just imagine Jesus taking a posture of openness and opening himself up to the very presence of God with all of his being. And no doubt the disciples tried to imitate him. They tried to do it themselves. They were watching him closely. When suddenly they beheld the Lord's body, his clothing, changing, transfiguring. He became full of light. And they beheld two figures standing on either side of him, the two great prophets of the Hebrew scripture, Moses on one hand, Elijah on the other. Peter, James, and John were just amazed. They were transfixed by what they saw. Don't you wish you had been there? Even though we can only read about it in print, we can only hear it spoken from the gospel. But we can imagine it, and it leaves us, even today, above wonder. What happened on that mountain? It's a story so beautiful that it's saved for this last Sunday of the season of light, Epiphany. A story to end this long season, a season where Jesus' glory is shown week by week in the stories of his life. It's a mountaintop story. The Gospel of Matthew has more stories about mountains, interestingly, than any of the other Gospels. You have the Mount of Temptation, the Sermon on the Mount, you have the Mount of Olives where he prayed the night before he died, and the Mount where Jesus commissions his disciples to go forth and make more disciples, make disciples of all the nations. About 7 years ago, I went on a pilgrimage with a group that wanted to walk on all the mountains that Jesus walked. It felt especially important to me to ascend Mount Tabor, in the hope of drawing closer to God, to actually be on the holy mountain where Jesus was transfigured. And so our group boarded this bus, and we went in our way up these switchbacks about halfway up the mountain, and then we had to transfer into little jitneys a little further, and finally the last ascent to the top, you had to hike. And we got out and walked up that last bit, and there at the top, our chaplain, who was a monk named Brother Mark, Mass, he invited us to come and gather under this trellis and share the Holy Eucharist. And it struck me how wonderful that was, to commune with God and with one another at the summit of Mount Tabor. And then it struck me as odd that Brother Mark used an offertory sentence that I'd never heard used as one in the Eucharist. And it was a quote from the Song of Solomon. He said, "He invited me to his banqueting table, and his intention towards me was love." So after communion, we had 1 hour to spend in silence, alone, on Mount Tabor. What a gift, I thought. Here I have yearned for a mountaintop experience, and I traveled all the way from New Jersey, where I lived. I was away from my home, my family. Not just this 1 hour, but this whole trip was a gift, is a special time set aside to concentrate on what God wants. What is God's will for me in my life? If I could just focus on prayer and be open to the Lord, then maybe my path would be clear before me. So I went off as others did. I found an isolated place where I couldn't see any other people among the trees. And I tried to be still. But no specific message came to me. I was waiting. I asked for it. I didn't receive it. But instead, what kept coming into my mind, as much as I tried to clear it of everything, was that beautiful passage that Brother Mark had spoken. He invited me to his banqueting table, and his banner over me
believe was love. And that's what God's intention for you is also. I had to ask myself, Peggy, what were you expecting? Isn't that enough for you? That the banner over you is love, that God's intention towards you is love? We're invited to be with the holiest of holies, and to know that we'll be fed with all that we can ask for or desire. I certainly hope that I can be content with that. What more is there? Because God gives us the love that we hunger for, the communion that transfigures us. He gives us Christ, his only Son, who shows us the way through his every action, through his every word, the body of Christ given for us. And when we believe it, and when we receive it, we accept it, we really are changed. We really are transfigured into being God's people. A people of love and compassion. So that's the mountaintop experience. That's what can happen when we pray. It doesn't always happen, but it can. So we have to keep on keeping on and know deep within that we are beloved no matter what we've been through, no matter what our past looks like, and to know and accept this incredibly generous compassion of our Lord is to be changed. And we know that moments of bliss, mountaintop experiences, they don't last very long. They're like glimpses into heaven. They're like a foretaste of the heavenly banquet. They have to come to an end. We have to go back down that mountain and be responsible, face our noisy lives again, and engage with the world and all of its messes and brokenness. After communion at God's table, we have to leave the peace of this sanctuary, the fellowship of our beloved friends here who share our faith, and we have to go out these doors and be in that world again. But we carry Christ with us, don't we? Now, Peter didn't want to leave Mount Tabor. To capture the moment, he said, let me build a booth. One for you, Jesus, one for Moses, one for Elijah, blah, blah, blah. And suddenly, he's just talking about thinking. And all of a sudden, God interrupts him and he says, listen to my beloved son. Listen to him. And they fall down on the ground in fear, the disciples. But we see that it's Jesus himself who picks them up. He says, don't be afraid. He's there for us always, assuring us as our advocate, as our guide. Well, the theme of this transfiguration story really could be about prayer and listening. And to consider the art of listening, I have to thank Mark Grayson for this. We might tune into the actor, Anna Deere Smith, who really developed listening as a great skill, and she used it in her monologues, which have been shown on Broadway and on PBS, for 25 years of listening to people's stories, people in all walks of life. She was able to create her amazing character monologues. And we're in this ultra-information age where we're barraged with news and alternative news. And isn't it true that all this stuff is coming at us all the time through all our media devices? It's just careening at us. So much so that when we actually have a conversation with another human being, we think we already know what they're going to say. We've heard it all. So we don't listen. An authentic listening, says Anna Deere Smith, is more than processing info. It's more than hearing someone just talk. It's learning to hear for what makes people sing. And building trust through careful listening is to build relationships, asking questions that get to the heart of things, like, have you ever lost something precious? Or asking, what's most important to you? You know, everyone has their own authentic voice, but it takes real engagement with the other to hear that voice, and we could call it communing with be present to people and to listen more. The practice of listening, don't we need it in our world? How do we develop it? I think really it can be developed best through prayer, through the practice of prayer. God invites you and me to listen. Listen to what God is saying to his people. Because through his beloved Son, he invites us to his banqueting table. And his intention toward us is love.
Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you. We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, for Ian and Laura, our bishops, and all other bishops, priests, and deacons. Pray for Donald, our president, Daniel, our governor, and for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world. Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake. We pray for all refugees and displaced persons around the world, and for healing and wholeness for the sick, especially Bob, Lucille, Billy, Brian Dyser, David Smith, Eddie Blair, Tom, Jackie, Lee, Peter Swan, Claudia, Liz Shepherd, Bob and David, John, Martha Lou, Harlan, Shelley and family, Patricia, Suzanne, and Sean Sullivan. Have compassion on those who suffer from any kind of trouble. We pray for those who have died. Give to the departed eternal rest. We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
We lift up our brother Steve Smith, who Oregon City find a place to worship at lunchtime at a local church. And here come our kids.
I believe in God, the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. That's what I would say. I believe in God, the Father.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Because in the mystery of the Word made flesh, you have caused a new light to shine in our hearts, to give the knowledge of your glory in the face of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels, with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name.
Thank you.
for the people of God, take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Be on it, Make